through 4. And if I have 5, it's going to call recursive of 5. Recursive of 5 is going to call recursive of 4. And recursive of 4 is going to call recursive of 3. And recursive of 3 is going to call recursive of 2. Recursive of 2 is going to call recursive of 1. And if you go back to the program here, what happens if n equal to 1, it's going to return. So the answer is essentially it's going to return. But now, how many times is this program executed? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So the time complexity of this algorithm, if when n equal to 5, for example, the time complexity is 5. Therefore, it is order n. Okay. Now let's go back and just change this program. Suppose I take this here. I make this recursive of n minus 1 plus recursive of n minus 1. Okay, suppose I just call this. Let's see what happens to this time. So what's happening now? Again, let's start with 5. 5 is going to call recursive of n minus 1, 4 and 4. Because there are two calls here. Oops. Yeah, I have two calls, right? Recursive of n minus 1 plus recursive of n minus 1. Now 4 is going to call 3 and 3. 3 is going to call 2 and 2. Right? Okay, let me go back to this problem, okay? So initially what did we have? Let's look at this problem here. I just want you to don't worry about what this function does, okay? Initially this was the function. Recursive n equal to 1, return 1, else return recursive of n minus 1 is what we had, okay? So now what we did was we performed the time complexity of this game. Then this is what I did. Suppose I was calling recursive of 5. Then recursive of 5 is calling recursive of 4, 4 is calling 3, 3 is calling 2, and 2 is calling 1. So if I look at the time complexity of it, every time, now let's see how we perform time complexity in this particular case. Okay, so this operation is order 1, this operation is order 1, and this is also order 1. Okay, but this is being called again and again, right? So when you analyze recursive programs, what are we going to do now? I'm going to say that this is calling it, this is going to be order of n minus 1. So it's going to call. Okay, so what's happening here? So this recursive of n minus 1 is going to be called, right? So what are the time complexity of this? Let's leave it as a question mark. Then what is happening now? Let's go back to this example. So if you look at it, what are the time complexity of each execution of the recursive function? It's max of order 1, comma order 1. So what will this be? Because this is like a sum of two programs. There's a test here and then there is another two. These two statements make up parts of this program. Let me call this P1 and let me call this P2. If both are executed, time complexity is order 1. Okay. But here there is a problem. If this is not satisfied, it's calling recursive of n minus 1. Now what is recursive of n minus 1? Again it's going to execute this. That means it's going to do n minus 1 times order of 1. Okay. And when will it terminate? It will terminate when n equal to 1. So when I'm looking at the time complexity of it, the first time around recursive of 5, let's say it costs C. Recursive of 4 also costs some time C, and some time D. Okay? Because why do I write this as D separately? Primarily because here it's n equal to 1, return 1. Otherwise, there's something else that's happening here. And we assume that this cost is order P, whereas this cost for each execution of the loop, if n is not equal to 1, just this statement is going to cost C. Just the cost of calling the recursive function. So when you look at it, what is it that we are seeing here? If n is the number 5, if you notice, there are four C's plus a D. Okay, so the total time complexity of this, if n is the number 5, it's of the order of n. Okay. Now, what I did was, I said, I'm going to change this guy. If I change this guy such that, suppose I do this, let's erase this, remove all this. And all that I'm going to do is, I'm going to simply make, I have n minus 1 here, right? I'm going to simply divide it. So let's say I'm going to call this recursive of n minus 1 plus recursive of n minus 1. Now let's analyze the time complexity. Now if you look at the way this is being called, I'm calling recursive of 5. Each call to recursive is making two recursive calls here. It's calling recursive of n minus 1 plus recursive of n. So what's going to happen now? There are going to be two calls to recursive of 4. Recursive of 4 is again going to make two calls to, each recursive call to 4 is going to make two calls to recursive of 3. Here again two calls to recursive of 3. This two calls to recursive of 2 and so on. And this one finally is going to make 1, 1, 1, 1 when it will terminate. Okay. And so on. Now what is the time complexity of this? The previous function recursive was order n. Notice that there is nothing log n over there. Now if you count the total number of operations in this, 1, 2, 3, assuming that this cost is C, just like before. Okay. C. Cost of each one of these. This is D, 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 and so on. Then what is the overall cost that we see here? Okay. How many do we have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Okay. So that 15 C's. Plus, what do we have here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 16 D's. Okay. So now, if you look at the time complexity of this, now this is of the order of 2 to the power of 5 rather than linear. So that means it is of the order of 2 to the power of n. It is 15. Assuming that both C and D are approximately the same, we have 31 computations that are being made. I have made a call for n equal to 5, and we are having order of 2 to the power of 5. Actually, what are we having? 16 plus 51 is 31. Both are constants. Let me make both of them the same. Let me call 3 here. Therefore, there are 31 order 1 computations, which is approximately, which is equal to 2 to the power of 5 minus, okay? Or the time complexity is of the, ignoring the constant, the time complexity is of the order of 2 to the power of n, okay? So we saw one, notice that, I want you to appreciate this, okay? This is a very important example. If you notice here, we had first only this part. Let's say we had only up to here, right? Then what we did was I removed that listing and then I added this other recursive call. Just by increasing the recursive call twice, the time complexity, which was order n when only one recursive call was there, becomes order of 2 to the power of n. Okay. Are you understanding this? Is this clear? The person who asked the question?
Yes, it's clear. Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
time complexity can be linear, it can be logarithmic, it can be logarithm plus linear, whatever. Okay. For example, you can have complexities of this kind. Let me. It can be, for example, order of n plus log n. Nothing prevents something. Okay. Any of these kinds of things can be gotten in terms of complexity. Okay. So there are, if you, for example, if you look at something like selection sort, I think I've given you something which is n log n. If on the other hand, if I was doing a simple sort program, which is an ordinary sort program, let me say I want to do sort. And if I was doing selection sort, what I would do is I would start with for I equal to 0, I n plus say small, some variables are not defined, ignore it. All of you know what selection sort is. Selection sort is simply this. If I have, let us say, 4. Let's say I have suppose I have 4, 2, 6 and 5. What selection sort essentially does is it compares the first element with the other three elements that are there. Here 2 is the smallest element here. Let me let's see, I had 4, suppose I had something else, 4, 6, 5, and, okay. So what it will do is, this is the 0th element, this is the first element, second and third element. So what is going to happen now, 6 will get, it will, 4 will get, so 4 is assigned the value of small. Then 4 is compared with 6, 5 and 2. The location at which the smallest element is present is 3. Then what do we do here? For j equals I plus 1, j less than n, j plus plus, we do if a of j is less than small, then let me write it here. I define log equals j and we proceed. Okay, and this completes the formula over here. Then what we do finally is that I exchange what do we do next? What we essentially do is I set temp equal to a of I equals a of log and oops and a of log equals temp. Okay. So what are we doing? We're simply exchanging. What are we going to do here? We are finding the location of the smallest element, exchange the two of them, and this part is sorted. Then you go to the next element, find the next smallest. So what will happen here? 4 will be here. After the first pass through the array, what are we going to have here? We're going to have this and this. 2 will be here and 4 will be here. Okay. During the next pass through the array, this is the smallest element. We're starting with small equal to a of y. I compare with this, 4 is the smallest element here. Then we exchange these two elements. Okay. So what do I do now at the end of this? For example, now 6 will move from here. So you'll have 4 here and 6 here. and next 5, it compares and remains same. So this is how the sorting is going to happen. Okay. So let us look at the complexity of this one. If you look at it here, there are 3 statements: I equal to 0, I less than n, I plus plus. All these 3 statements, because each one is going to take constant time, the time complexity of the 4th statement is order. Time complexity of this statement is order. The time complexity of this statement is order. Similarly, I can combine all of these because this is like one whole, as much a sequence of the set of programs, this will be order. But what do we see here? This for loop is going to be maximum executed up to n times. Okay, first time it's going to do n minus 1, second time n minus 2, and so on. Therefore, when I look at if I look at time complexity of that, the outermost loop, ith loop for example, if I take first time it is executing n times, then it's doing n minus 1, and so on. And this one is executing n minus 1, n minus 2, up to okay, so this is exactly what we are going to see. So now, when you look at this over here, when you look at the time complexity of this, what we can say is that if you look at this particular program, the segment of the for loop, including all of this, has a time complexity of order, but it is in this particular form. There is a program within a program. The for loop declaration tells you how many times it's going to get executed. P2 is the time complexity. So if I look at the time complexity of the for loop, how many times it's getting executed? It's getting executed n times, or n or n minus 1. We do not distinguish between n minus 1. And the time complexity of P2, what is P2 now? It's getting executed 1 time. So that means, let's go back to this program here. This is P1. And this whole thing is P2. So P1 into P2 is the time complexity. Within this, this has a P3, which is again constant. So P1, P2, P3 is the time complexity that we're looking at. So when you're looking at this particular program, you're going to get order N into N, which is order N. Okay? So we saw 3 kinds of problems. One which takes order N. Another one which takes order 2 to the power of n. Another one which takes order n square. Let me show you one which takes log n. Let's say I have I equal to 1. And I say while I less than n, let me say n is some 15. I is equal to 2 star. Can you tell me now? I've written a small segment of code. What is the complexity of this part? I'm asking you a question. Now. What is the time complexity of this code? Can you answer me this question? I'm asking you a question. Person who asked me the logarithm, can you tell me what it is? So this part, if you look at it here, what is interesting is how many times is this loop executed? So if you look at it, I equal to 1, n equal to 15. So the first time when I look at the value of I, it was 1, then it becomes 2, then it becomes 4, then it becomes 8, then it becomes 16. So when it becomes 16, it does not satisfy, it comes out. So how many times is being executed? 1, 2, the loop is being executed 4 times. Okay. Now suppose I make n is equal to 32. Okay. Or n equal to 31, let me say. To keep it. Sorry. Suppose I make it n equal to 31. Then how many times will that execute? Can somebody answer? I don't want to do a monologue. It will do 5 times. So now, in terms of n, what is the time complexity now?
What is the 2 raised to the power n. Order
not
2 raised to power n.
It is order of log n. Because n equal to 15, order of log of 15, okay, if I take the roof of it, for example, is going to be what? 2 to the power of 4 is 16, right? Therefore, this will be 4. Similarly, for 31, if I take the order of log of 15 to the base 2 root of that, this is going to give me 5. Okay? So, this one is a program whose time complexity is order of log n, although there is a while block over here. The previous problem, for example, why was it order n for each of the loops? Because we are incrementing I by only 1 over here. Notice here, I less than n, I plus plus. Every time, we are only incrementing I by 1. Therefore, the loop goes through outermost loop runs n times, innermost loop, inner loop, for example, first time it will run n minus 1 times, next time it will run n minus 2 times and so on. And when you take the sum of all of that, it is of the order of n squared. Okay, are you clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so this is what time complexity is all about. Most important in time complexity, when you write your code, please be very, very careful. I'd like you to look at this particular example again. This recursion example is a dangerous example, actually. This one, for example, if I look at recursive, only one recursion call, like we did, for example, let us say I had a something like this, only with the yellow. Okay, then it was order n. But as soon as I added one more recursive call, then it became 2 to the power of n. So it can become exponential type complexity. And if you look at it, the easiest way to compute time complexity, my advice to you would be simply, especially recursive programs is where the difficulty is, just draw, this is called the recursion tree. This is called the recursion tree. Okay. And simply count all the operations. For each operation, you assign some constant or whatever, depending upon what is being done within that. Okay. For example, in something like quick sort, what are we doing? What is the time complexity? Can we look at the time complexity of quick sort? What happens in that? I'm asking you a question.
Order of log n.
It's not order of log n. It's order of n log n. At best, that way. Why so? So you can also write it in this particular, I'll show you one. In quick sort, let's take this. Okay, array, what are we doing? I don't remember the exact code, but nevertheless. Let's say I'm looking at this. Something like this. Let's say we have this. So what do we do in quick sort? Let's say I'm choosing the middle element as the pivot element. Then what are we doing? What do you ensure in quick sort?
We check the first element and make it compare with the other elements, the other successive elements.
Not other successive elements. You compare the elements on this side of the pivot element with that of the elements on the right side. And then what do? You exchange them if they are out of order with respect to the pivot element. So what do you see over here? Notice that 12 is the pivot element. 8 is smaller than 12, so no problem. So you move forward. 15 is larger than the pivot element. So it's on the wrong side of the pivot element. And then you do the same thing on the right hand side. 13 is larger than 15, so no problem. But 4 is should be on the left hand side of the pivot. So I come from this side. Actually, I start from here. Then what I do is I have one pointer which starts here, one pointer which starts here. 8, for example, 8 is in the correct place, no problem. With respect to 12, it should be on the left hand side. Now here 11 on the other hand should be on the left hand side of 12, but is on the right hand side. 15 should be on the left hand side of right hand side of 12, but it's on the left hand side. So what do I do now? I exchange 15 and 11. Okay? And I keep repeating this until the pointers comes. So can you tell me now, that is one pass through the array. So at the end of this, every one of them being compared, I'll have something like this. 8, I'll have 11 here, and I'll have 6 here, which is just fine. And 12 will move, 4 will come here, and I'll have 13, and I'll have 12. Then also one. So let's see after. Okay, let's look at this one pass of the array. So what happens after one? The first time around, 8 is remaining as it is. 15 and 11 gets exchanged. 11 comes here. 15 will go. Okay, then 6 is on the right side with respect to 12. Now 12 and 10 are compared. 10 will come here, and what will happen? 12 will. Ten is small. 12 will be, what did we take? 1, 2. Let's say these are the indices. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. So then, what are we trying to do over here now? So 8 is compared with 11. So 8 is on the left hand side. And 11 is on the, so 11 is should have been on the left hand side, but it's on the right hand side. So you wait there. Then you go to the next number here. So you move this pointer from here to here. Then what happens? 15 and 11, because 11 should be on the left of 15, we exchange the two elements. Okay. Next, what we do? 6 is on the correct side of 12. So I don't have to do anything. Then here I am at 10. Okay. Alright. So then what happens? Now I am stuck here. I wait here. But then what happens? 10 is on the wrong side of 12. Okay. So what do I do now? I move 10 here and I move 12 here. Okay. Then what do I have? Now I have 13 and 4. 13 is on the wrong side of 12. So 12 comes here and 13 goes away. So now what do we have? Then again I have 12 and 4. So 4 will come here and 12 will go over here. Okay. So what this quick sort essentially does is that it will. So finally when I am looking at quick sort, it will give me 4 here and 12 here. Now if you look at the right hand side of 12, all the elements are larger than 12. Left hand side of 12, all the elements are smaller than 12. So it approximately divides the array into two parts. Now my question to you is, during one pass, now we have completed one pass through the array. During one pass through the array, can you tell me how many elements were seen? Can you answer me this question? Do you understand my question?
Pardon, ma'am. Can you please repeat?
Yeah. See, we started out with this array. Okay. Then what did we do? We had one pointer I here, another pointer J here from which we started. Then what we did was, we compared the two elements with respect to the pivot element. 12 is our pivot element, let us say. Then what we did was, as long as the numbers were less than 12, we let them be as it is. If they are greater than 12, less than 12 on the left hand side. And it should be greater than 12 on the right hand side. Now what happens is, on the right hand side I have 11, which is smaller than 12, therefore it has to move to the left. So what do I do now? When I move I by 2, I plus 1, let's say I equal to 1, there's 15 here, which should have been on the right hand side of 12. And then what do I do? And 11 should be on the left hand side of 12. So what do? I exchange both the numbers. I keep repeating this, including the pivot element can move. Okay. So let's say next I came to 6, 6 was in the correct place. Then I'm looking at 12 and 10. 10 should be on the left hand side. So I exchange 12 in 10. Then 12 moves there. And then again here 13 is on the wrong side of 12. Because if you look at it here, where was it now? At the end of it, after that operation with, let me say I had 8, 11, 6 and 10 here, 13 here, 4 here, 12 here and 11 is what we had. Okay. Now again what happens when I look at 13 here, it's on the wrong side of 12. So what do? I exchange it back again and it will give me 12 and 4 here. And again I exchange 12 and 4 back because it's again on the right side. So at the end of one pass through the array, it divides it into two parts. In this example, it divides into 5 and 3. Okay. So my question to you is, once I have completed one pass through the array, what do we have? With respect to the pivot element, we have that all the elements on the left hand side are smaller than the pivot element or equal to pivot element. And on the right hand side, they are greater than the pivot element. My question to you is, how many elements were seen during one pass of the array? Do you understand my question?
Yes.
I went through one pass. It's still not sorted. So now, what is interesting? We fix out, what do? We go through this and we simply what I will do is, I look at this over here. Now only these elements need to be sorted, these elements need to be sorted. Okay. Once again, we find the pivot element, repeat the same process. So my question to you, during one pass through the array, how many elements were seen? Can you answer that?
Five elements.
All the elements were seen because I compared this with this, I compared this with this. Every element in the array was seen. So if I was going to write a recurrence equation, I would write this that T of m equal to 2 T of or T of n minus I plus T of I plus all elements. Are you with me on this? All the every element of the array what the complexity of quick sort is going to be. If we are clever and do it, if for example if the array is a lucky array, the good array, I'll have T of n is equal to 2 T of n by 2 plus C times n. So what does this time complexity lead to? What will be the time complexity of this? I am asking a question now.
Sorry ma'am, I don't know the answer.
See, basically what happens is, notice that every time, so now let us look at a best case, okay? In the best case, I am going to have something which was 8 elements long. And let us say it got divided into two halves, 4, 4. Then it became, it became 2 and 2 and 2. And finally, it was one element long. Okay. This is how the recursion and quick sort will work. If you look at the algorithm which was done in the video. So now what is interesting is, every time in quicksort, the first time all n elements are looked at. Next time, although they are two different parts, again all elements are looked at. the third time again all n elements, all the 8 elements, and fourth time to all the 8 elements. What is the depth here? This depth, for example, if n is equal to 8, how many times? 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 times the elements are looked at. Therefore, it's log of 8 to the base 2. And each time it is being looked at n times. Therefore, this 8 log of 8 to the base 2. Therefore, others of the time complexity of quick sort is, in the best case, is order n log n. Best case. Okay. What is the worst case time complexity of quick sort? I'm asking you a question.
I don't know the answer, ma'am.
let me go back to this example. Okay, what will happen in this example? See, if you notice here in this example that I worked out, that I tried to work out for you, it divided instead of 4, 4, it divided into 5 elements and 3. In the worst case, Quicksort can do such that divides it to 7 and 1 in the first pass. Oops. 7 and 1. In the second pass, now this guy is already, 1 is already sorted. This becomes 6 and 1. And so on. So how deep will it get if I did that? What I'm saying is there can be a scenario where I have these 8 elements and the pivot element is chosen such that I have one element here. All elements to the left are smaller than the pivot element. Only one element is larger than the pivot element. Then let's say I get here, this is 7 and this is 1. Then the next time around, again I have chosen another pivot element on the 7 elements. And again it divides into 6 and 1. Then it keeps doing this. How deep will this go? 5 and 1. 4 and 1. 3 and 1 and so on. How deep will this become? If you notice, in the previous case, I said, if it is divided exactly into 2, the depth is log n. If, on the other hand, every time it's dividing the array into one element and the rest of the elements, one element and the rest of the elements, then how deep will it get? I'm asking you a question. See, if you, let's go back to this example. First time it was 4, 4, right? Then it became 2, 2, 2, 2. What I'm going to do now? When it becomes 4, 4, again I'll choose the pivot element, and then make sure that elements on left and right are, or you know, are smaller than the pivot element on the left and greater than the pivot element on the right. I'll ensure. Same thing I'll do with this one. The next time around, it will get divided, let's say, into 2, 2, all 4 of them, and then of course finally divided into 1, 1. But if it so happens that the pivot element chosen is such that the first time 7 elements, 1, after this first pass through the array. Next pass through the array, 6, 1. That one is just left as it is, there is no recursion on it. Because already it become one element. This becomes now 5 and 1. This becomes 4 and 1. This becomes 3 and 1. This becomes 2 and 1. See, if you look at the depth of this, for example, it's as long as the array. Okay? So that is when the time complexity becomes order. Every time you are looking at all the 8 elements, okay, whatever be the size of the array. So what happens is, in such a case, time complexity of Quicksort. As I said, Quicksort is an algorithm where every pass through the array, you are looking at all the elements. So I looked at n elements here, 8 elements here, 8 elements here, however the elements are divided, you are going to keep looking at all the 8 elements. So what's going to happen is that the depth is going to become n or 8, and every pass I'm also looking at 8 elements. Therefore, the time complexity is order n squared. Is this clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So the worst case complexity of Quicksort is order n squared. But you may ask the question, why is Quicksort called Quicksort? quick spot algorithm.
Please repeat.
See, quick sort should do something quick sort, right? It's not doing anything quickly at all. If the particular elements are chosen such that it is always choosing the pivot element wrongly, then quick sort performs very poorly, right? But what is interesting is that you can, there are, in a probabilistic way, if you look at it, if I take n symbols and look at the permutation of the symbols, the probability that you will choose a pivot element which is always going to be, for example, the largest element or the element which is one smaller than the largest element, probability is very low. So what happens is, what still works is the average case time complexity of order n squared. Okay, that's why it's called order n log n. That's why it's called okay. Because what I'm saying is, this kind of a scenario where I'm having 7, 1, 6, 1, 5, 1, 5, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 1, 1, and so on, or 4, 1, 1, 1, 1, is very, very, probability of this happening, very, very good. And you can actually show that this is a very good time complex for the fixed one. Okay. Alright. So it's actually a quick sort of. Because the probability of the array getting divided like this, always one element and the rest, one element and the rest, one element, is very, very there. Okay, it's very important. Alright. Are there any other questions?
Ma'am, I want to ask that what are the various garbage collection technique in data structure?
What do you want to do in garbage collection? Basically, you want a cleaning up to be done, right? Are you talking about with respect to the garbage collection schemes that there are in Java? Or
data structure.
In data structures, there is no specific garbage collection scheme. You keep track of all the pointers and you pick them up yourself. In Java, a specific language, what is done is, it looks at, when you see what is garbage collection all about, you want to get rid of, there are, you have done a malloc, okay? You make a malloc and you have allocated some array, some memory to an array. Now what you want to do is, you forget to free it. Ideally you should free it, okay? If you don't free it, then let's say, you know, let me give you an example of here. Yeah? Let's say I have a function here. Suppose I have, you know, int, let me call it find something, and some arguments, int star a. Now suppose I do some a is equal to some. Malloc of 10 star size of int. Okay. Suppose I've done the malloc in this function. Okay. Then what is happening is, let me not take int a, let me say there is an int b here, star b. I've done this to b. Because a is being passed as argument, I still have a reference. Suppose b was done with this. Okay. Then let us say I was B. I defined an array B and then I did the allocation for it. Okay. I did a malloc for this. Now, after doing this, let us say I came out some, I had something, I returned something here, returned some value. I wrote a lot of code. I came out, but I forgot to free B. I did not do this. Okay. Then what do we have now? You have an array which is being allocated but has not been freed. And then you have no connection to the array because this array B is not being passed as argument to this, so they can free it outside. Okay. So this is something which is lost. So what Java tries to do is that, I hope I'm answering your question, I hope it will be the kind of question you are interested in. What Java tries to do is, this is called a dangling pointer. This B here is a dangling pointer. It's not, it has no connection at all. Okay. So what it does is, it looks for all of this, and at regular intervals of time, it cleans up the memory. But I must warn you, although Java loves this, this is a very, very bad programming practice. I generally advise that you always remember what you have allocated, and if you don't need it anymore, always free it. I hope this answers your question. Okay? There's nothing like garbage collection in data structures, as far as I, from whatever I know. Did you have anything else in mind? Okay, so garbage collection is a specific facility that is available in some languages where all these pointers which have lost their connections are cleaned up automatically. But as I said, my advice to you is, this is not a good idea. You should not do that. Okay? Because what happens is, even in Java, you'll find that if you run up, it's normally garbage collection in Java, for example, happens only when it reaches some limit in the memory. So many times, if you're doing something that is interactive, you will find that your program simply freezes because it's busy cleaning up the memory of all these bad pointers which are there. So general advice to you is, when you code, you allocate, you deallocate. Always remember to do that. Okay? Are you with me on this?
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Are there any other questions?
Dronacharya seems to be having a question.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Dronacharya, if you have a question, please come in.
Good afternoon.
Yeah, please sit down.
Ma'am, I want to ask you, how many stacks are required to implement a queue?
You tell me. This is a great question.
Actually, I asked you.
Yeah, I know you asked me, but can you think of how to work it? What is the difference between a stack and a queue? A stack is?
FIFO and FIFO.
FIFO. So what do I have to do? If I have to make a stack, which is FIFO, well, I'm only having stacks with me, right? So I have to make a stack which is FIFO, then how many stacks would I require? I push things, right? But then when I pop things of the stack, what do I require? I require that the first element which was pushed is what is popped off the stack, correct? Because it's going to behave like a queue, correct?
Yep.
So then what do I need? So what happens? If I have P elements which I am pushing onto the stack, then I want it to behave like a queue. That means I have to pop off all the P minus 1 elements. Okay. All the P elements. But P elements have to be kept. So I need another stack onto which I push it. So to implement a queue using stacks, you need two queues. Is that clear?
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Understand? Okay. Can you explain the algorithm, what I suggest? What I told you just now, back to me, I want to hear. I'm asking you to repeat the algorithm.
You said ki we need two queues to implement a stack. I asked ki how many stacks are has to be implemented to form a queue.
That's precisely what I answered. I said you need two stacks to implement a queue.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Okay, can you explain to me how it can be done?
Yeah.
I just told you the algorithm. I want to see whether you're listening or not.
Actually, you told now, if we are pushing one stack on a queue, and then we need to push another stack on a queue to implement that thing. But you said we need a contest to push two stacks for a queue.
Kate, you got it all wrong. Let me just show you what I mean by this. suppose I want to, let's say I want to put the following elements into a queue. Okay. B, C, D, E onto a queue. What do I have with me? I have with me a stack. Okay. A and B and C and D and E. Now, if I want to make the stack behave like a queue, which is the element that I have to pop out? I have to pop out the element A, but it's at the bottom of the stack. So what do I do? This is stack 1, this is stack 2. So what I do is I push it onto the stack. Push it onto the stack. Okay. And then I pop this, push it onto the stack. And then I pop this, push it onto the stack. Then what do I have? I have the element A, which is on the top of the stack. Next I can pop this element, which is because it is on the top of the stack. So you need two stacks to implement a queue. Are you clear now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Why do you need the two stacks? Can you explain to me?
Because we know that only from a stack only we can take out the element from the top and put it back from the top. Therefore, we need two stacks so that one stack could be emptied so that the element of first stack can be put in the second stack so that we can use the element that are exactly down. Like we can use A when we bring that on second stack on the top.
Yes, exactly. Okay, is this clear now?
Yeah.
Implement. Yeah.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Yes, tell me.
Ma'am, I want to have a question that how to find the middle value in a linked list with a one pass, only traveling to one only time.
Only one time you're passing. Let me just.
Yes,
think.
Ma'am.
Do you know the number of elements in the linked list?
No, ma'am.
You need to keep track of the number of elements which are before a given. So, let me just give you a hint on this. I think I'm not sure absolutely, but if you start with, let us say, the first two elements and take them to be the sentinel and then count how many elements are there in between them and keep track of the middle number every time. So, if I'm just thinking about this, I feel you could do something of this kind. I'm not absolutely sure. Let me... Now in this list, for example, we would require to get 1, 2, 3, 5, 7, 8 and 15 is what we have. We want the number 5. Correct? Then what I'm wondering is I start with 5. I assume this is the beginning and the 15 is the end. Then I get 3, 5 and 15. 5 is the middle value because I'm just looking at only one element every time. Then, because I know there's only one element in between, then I look at 2. 2 goes before this. Therefore, 2 is before 3. That means there are two elements before 5 and one element after 5, which is still 5 may be the middle value or 3 may be the middle value. You can keep repeating this 1, 2, 3, 5, and 15. Then here now 3 becomes the middle value, 1 which is higher than this. I have to keep both of them. So just 3 and the last two of these guys. Every time I add an element, that element should go before the middle value or after the middle value. That's what we need to keep track of. And the middle element also moves, just like in Pixel. You're saying you cannot go anywhere back and forth. Are you sure of this question? Are you sure that this question, was this question given somewhere? I'm asking you a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Then where did you get this question from?
Audible, ma'am.
Where did you get this question from?
I have in mind, ma'am.
in your mind.
Yes, ma'am.
I have a feeling you need to keep track of too many things here.
Sure,
because
ma'am.
If it's an array, for example, you can do a partition sort. In fact, that is how it's done for quicksort if it's an array. Linked list, I'm not absolutely sure whether it can be done.
Okay.
Because there's no way of going back and forth unless it's a doubly linked list. As far as I know, in a linked list, you may not be possible to find the middle value unless you can go back and forth. I'm not sure. But in an array, yes, you can do it. You can find the middle value.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah? Let me think about it. If I find the solution, I'll ask them to post it on the forum.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. Are there any other questions?
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Yes. Yeah.
Ma'am, what is the use of keyword this in string?
Keyword?
This.
Keyword this in? This we do not use in C or C++.
This pointer
in
string.
This pointer, for example, is primarily to point to the current instance of the given object. It's pointing to the current instance of the given object.
And ma'am, when to go for recursion and when for iteration?
Always iteration is preferred over recursion. For the simple reason, iteration is very expensive in terms of memory and the amount of bookkeeping that you have to do. But recursion comes very naturally for us to write. Okay. Always, yes, for example, what we would do is, you can write a recursive function because it's very natural and easy to write. Then afterwards, you try and convert it to an iterative function.
Okay.
Because the home bookkeeping that has to be done on an iterative function in terms of, for example, if you're using recursion, okay, the state of the function should be stored in memory. That is the problem. Every recursive call till the last call has to be kept in memory. That's the drawback.
Okay.
But some functions cannot help it. Okay. Then any other questions?
CSIT, Dronacharya, any questions please? Bhagdevi, do you have any questions?
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, what is generic pointer?
Generic pointer, I don't know what a generic pointer is. Where did you hear this term?
Ma'am, what is generic pointer?
In what?
In C++.
I'm not sure. I don't know.
Ma'am, it is denoted as void star.
Void star?
P. P is a pointer.
Okay. Void star P. What is it? Basically, you can typecast it with. You can typecast such a pointer to a character, an integer, to what. Void star is normally used. Because it has no specific, void has no particular type. But the good point is, but it's actually not good to do that in a pedantic compiler, like your exam is going to be. You cannot do that, okay? You can't typecast anything to anything, but sometimes it's convenient to do that.
Okay, ma'am, thank you.
But it's not a good idea, because what happens is, it's like an address. You're simply typecasting an address.
Okay, ma'am, thank you.
That is changed, yeah. Bye. Good luck for your exam.